2,000 years have passed since the destruction of the Second Temple, and more than 150 years have gone by since measurements and scientific examinations began in Jerusalem. For more than 25 years, the Old City of Jerusalem has been in Israeli hands. After extensive excavations, the basic problems in the research of the Second Temple in Jerusalem have still not been solved. Where is Antonia's Tower? Where is the Chakra? What is the root of the Second Wall? Where is the Hasmonean Palace? And even as regards the siting of the temple itself, researchers are divided in their opinions. There are those who say that the Dome of the Rock is the Holy of Holies. Others contend that the Dome of the Rock is the site of the altar. There are those who believe that the temple was sited in the northern part of the enclosure, while others put forward the view that the site of the temple was on the southern side. By way of a new method of research, it is possible to guess where the site of the temple was and where the remains of it are to be found. This method is based on a spatial concept which investigates the relationship between the temple and its immediate surrounds in a three-dimensional manner. In the course of comparing the evidence in literature we have available to us and the unique topography of Jerusalem. The Mount Moriah area in the eastern part of the Old City. In the center of the area, there is the Dome of the Rock. At its southern end, the Al-Aqsa Mosque. On the south side, the Huldah Gates. And at the eastern tip, the Golden Gate. While on the west, there are the Barclay Gate, Warren Gate, Robinson's Arch, and Wilson's Arch. On the basis of the method normally applied by researchers and scientists, the temple was sited on the upper plaza, and the site of the Holy of Holies was at the place at which the Dome of the Rock stands. Large sections of the wall of the Moriah area, which can be seen today, were, in the opinion of researchers, constructed by Herod. The area is in the form of a rectangular trapezoid, the average size of which is 500 by 300 meters, approximately 150 dunams. In contrast to this are two opposing views. According to the original sources which we have available to us, the size of the enclosure was approximately 500 by 500 amma, that is approximately 250 by 250 meters, only 60 dunams. Whereas, according to Josephus Flavius, the size of the area was ris by ris, about 200 by 200 meters, which is approximately 40 dunams. The area today is three times greater than the original sources state. And its shape as described above differs from that mentioned by the original sources. Do the sources describe the area known to us today? According to the Mishnah, the difference in heights between the Huldah Gates and the Holy of Holies was approximately 10 meters, with approximately a 39 degree separation between the entrance level to the Temple Mount and the level of the temple. In actual practice, the difference in heights is about 20 meters, with approximately an 80 degree separation between the entrance and the level of the temple. The assumption made by researchers was that there were tunnels running from the Huldah Gates to the Temple Mount Plaza. However, in the various written sources, there is no mention at all of tunnels of this sort. From the Huldah Gates, one directly entered the Royal Vestibule and the Temple Mount Square. The tunnels which exist today are from a later period and cannot serve as proof that there were also tunnels such as these in the days of the Second Temple. If the level of the double gate and the triple gate is the level of the entrance to the Temple Mount, The temple itself must have been lower than the level of the rock inside the Dome of the Rock. Antonia's tower was located north of the Temple Mount according to the original sources. It was sited on a hill about 25 meters high. Today, on the northern side of the Moriah area, there is no hill of a similar height. The Elomria school building, which in the opinion of a number of researchers is Antonia's tower, is in fact built on a raised rock, but its height is no more than 5 meters. And a number of researchers have already expressed doubts in relation to this identification based on stratigraphic and other considerations. If that is so, where is the hill on which Antonia's tower stood? Between the site of the temple at the place where the Dome of the Rock stands and the assumed site at which Antonia's tower stood, 19th century English researchers found a moat having a width of about 46 meters, which was covered and which cannot be seen today. According to the description in the sources, there was no moat or trench between Antonia's tower and the Temple Mount. The two edifices were adjacent to each other, and by descending a series of steps, one gained access from Antonia's tower to the Temple Mount Plaza. As opposed to this, the sources say that there was a moat on the northern side of Antonia's tower, which was intended to protect the fortress from the north. It is possible that Antonia's tower was south of this trench. This trench is a starting point for understanding the area. Josephus Flavius describes the fact that the Bizita Hill was located north of the Temple Mount and obscured the view of the temple from the north. Also, on the basis of cross-sections made from north to south, as well as according to the model of Jerusalem at the Holy Land Hotel, it's possible to see the temple from the north as far away as Ramallah. If one assumes the temple was indeed at the place where the Dome of the Rock stands. In order to obscure a view from the north, it's necessary to lower the level of the temple. In the Book of the Jewish Wars, it's described that from the Hasmonean Palace, which was close to the bridge which leads to the temple, in the region of today's Jewish Quarter, Agrippus looked out over the place at which offerings were sacrificed on the Azarah. This fact incensed the Jews, who built a wall in order to block out the view of the Azarah. The Roman soldiers who patrolled along the western threshold of the Temple Mount wall were unable to look onto the Azarah and demanded that the Jews demolish the wall. The Jews objected to this and eventually even obtained the consent of the Emperor Nero, and the wall remained in place. A special examination shows that the original walls of the Azarah prevented any view of the abattoirs, even without the addition of a new wall. Only from a height of about 75 meters can one see what goes on in the Azarah. In Jerusalem, there was never a building of such height, either then or now. In the time of the Second Temple, even from the highest towers, the Patzael and the Hippicus Towers, which were in the region of the Citadel of David at present times, it was not possible to see what went on in the Azarah. The only way of seeing the sacrifice of offerings would have been to lower the level of the temple. The water canal supplied the needs of Jerusalem. They start off in the area of the Hebron Mountains, from where they passed through Solomon's pools and flowed to Jerusalem. The lowest ancient canal reached the Temple Mount through the Jewish Quarter and the Wilson Bridge. According to the ancient authorities, the water conduit supplied water to the high priest's mikveh, which is a ritual bath, located above the water gate, and also supplied water for rinsing the Azarah of the blood of the sacrificial offerings. An examination of the level shows that if we assume the temple was at the site of the Dome of the Rock, then the water canal was lower than the level of the Azarah. and the level of the water gate. The high priest would have been unable to immerse himself in the spring waters, and the Azarah would not have been capable of being washed. In order for the water canal to fulfill its function, it is necessary to lower the level of the temple. Furthermore, on the basis of the level of the water conduit, it's possible to assess the exact level of the Temple Mount. Let us sum up and say that the level of the Hulda Gates, the level of Antonia's Citadel, the view from North Jerusalem, and the view of Agrippus, the level of the water conduit, all point independently to the fact that the level of the Temple Mount was lower than the level of the present plaza. Where can the temple be sited? The region of the upper plaza is rocky. The northern region is rocky as well. The location at which we can place the temple at a low point is in the southern region, between the Dome of the Rock and the Al-Aqsa Mosque, in the region of Al-Qas, the trophy. Electronic tests which have been carried out along the length of the western, southern, and eastern walls indicate that in the southern region, below the Hulda Gates, the area is constructed of empty vaults, which are perhaps the kipim mentioned in the ancient written sources. And maybe, above the level of the Hulda Gates, the area is full of ruined antiquities, which are perhaps the remains of the temple. Moreover, it's possible that the large amphorous water holes, which are found in the southern region of the area, are in fact the remains of the Jewish temple. According to our estimate, the level of the Temple Mount is the level of the Hulda Gates, because the moat mentioned in the authorities was north of Antonia's Citadel. After all, Antonia's Tower was located at the place at which the Dome of the Rock stands today. And indeed, the difference of levels, as between the Dome of the Rock, on which Antonia's Tower stood, and the level of the Hulda Gates, the level of the Temple Mount, is about 50 amas, as described in the words of Josephus Flavius. Lowering the level of the Temple Mount Plaza indeed does not allow a view from the north in the direction of the Temple Mount. Agrippus was able to look out over the Azarah from his palace in a building the height of which did not exceed 25 meters. And the water conduit did allow the supply of water for washing and rinsing the Azarah, as well as a supply of water to the mikveh, which was above the water gate at which the high priest immersed himself on Yom Kippur. The conclusions of this research represent the start of a new path, likely to shed new light on Jerusalem generally and the Temple Mount in particular. A need exists for further examinations, electronic tests, magnetic and seismic tests, as well as infrared photographs, which would be likely to reveal to us important and considerable information about the temple and its contents. We call on each and every one of you to lend a hand in revealing the hidden secrets of the Temple Mount. Thank you.